I'm going to critique science in this video. Now, I am an English major, but I am friends with chem and bio majors, and I have access to Google, which in the context of this show makes me a circumstantial expert.
That's it. That's my intro.
Hi, I'm Amanda, and you're watching Swell Entertainment. Now, I had not heard of Another Life until my coworker came to me and said, Amanda, I need you to watch this show so that you can confirm how bad it is for me. And suddenly, it started getting recommended to me on Netflix, which I found funny. I originally was going to run through 10 of the stupidest things about Another Life from Netflix. However, I kept stacking categories, and I was having a difficult time narrowing things down to 10 categories because there's just so much about this show that I want to complain about that's so stupid. And I want to spoil as much of the show for you as I can because I don't want you to watch the show. It's very bad. So instead of doing that, I'm just gonna run through a bunch of things that I can't stand and things I didn't like. Hopefully this isn't gonna be 400 years long because that's what the original video was going to be, was 400 years long, and I don't think any of you like my content that much to tolerate that. Netflix's Another Life episode 1 starts out with an unidentified flying object coming to Earth and landing in a field and then basically leaving a probe on Earth and them calling it the artifact. Somehow they find that there is also a signal that mimics the one of the artifact coming from a different planet in a far-off galaxy, and they decide to get a team together to go and see if they can establish first contact with the alien life, do a threat assessment, and then potentially protect Earth. The story from there splits into two teams. We have Nico Beckenridge, the captain, piloting the Salvare, which is the ship that's going to the other planet, with her team of 20-somethings and the ship's AI, William, and then also everything happening on Earth with Nico's husband, God, what's his name, I keep forgetting, Eric, and then his science team trying to figure out what the artifact is from Earth. I don't care about anything happening on Earth aside from Selma Blair's character, Harper. She's the only interesting thing that's happening on Earth. I don't care about anything else. Before I start going through some of the stupider points of this show, let me just start out by saying I'm trying to figure out who their target audience was. If you look at the bare bones of what the show should be, the space show dealing with adult content, dealing with adult language, then the show is looking at a target audience of my age and up. However, the dialogue and some of the concepts are so basic and high school, it makes me think that if you were to just take out the fucking and everyone saying the word fuck, this show would be great for middle school and high school people because it is just that basic. And it also makes me feel like I was losing brain cells. Like I said, I barely care about what's happening on Earth, so I'm barely going to talk about it. Episode 1 starts out with them realizing, oh, where we were aiming to is actually not where we're supposed to be going because it was just a blip and none of us caught it. It was a malfunction in the system or whatever. We're actually going farther. It's gonna add more time to our trip. So Nico and William, the ship's AI, wake up all of Team A. I don't understand how any of these people ended up on Team A. Like I said, all of them are in their 20s and they're all the most infuriating people. Some of them are just so bad at their jobs, and if they're not bad at their job, then they're incapable of taking something seriously. A lot of them complain a lot. First off, again, this is Team A. Nico was included in Team A. Nico is still dealing with a lot of questions and anxiety and guilt over another mission that she was second in command on the ship the Pilgrim 9 years earlier. At first, we're led to believe that she's the only survivor of that mission, but then later we kind of see that maybe there were others, but let's go with the fact that she's the only survivor because then that fits the narrative, because again, it's inconsistent, but that's the most consistent one they stuck with, that she is the only survivor of that mission. Find out that the second in command for the Salvare mission is Ian Yerxa, who she trained, but she also said he's not ready. He was originally going to be the captain because the Salvare is his ship, but they didn't think he was qualified. She doesn't think he's qualified, so she steps up as the captain. And then we have a bunch of other people who are also part of his crew. Now, we're led to believe that they've all been to space before, but some of them, it seems like they haven't. One in particular, Sasha, who's like the politician and he's supposed to be like the diplomat to represent the US when they make first contact with aliens. I couldn't stand Sasha the entire time. His brain later gets taken over by an alien, and that's the most interesting thing about him. I know as I'm running through this, it sounds like I'm trying to give you an aneurysm. That's what I felt the show was doing to me. So really, I'm just putting you into the show. I'm giving you the experience without you having to actually watch it. We also have Zane, who's the like ship doctor. They seem to be the only competent one consistently throughout the show. We have Javier and Oliver. Javier is the computer scientist, technician, whatever. Oliver is the second in command mechanical engineer, but they both work under August. August is the head mechanical engineer. She's also the youngest on the ship. We find out that her brother was actually on the Pilgrim and died on the mission that Nico was second in command on. I'm sorry, who made that call to allow August or Nico on the same ship, because that seems like an oversight. Like, maybe there's some animosity there. Maybe they shouldn't work together. Her brother being on the Pilgrim was apparently so insignificant. They never have a conversation about it. It's very weird. A lot of this show and a lot of my critiques for this show are going to be, why was this choice made? Oh, we also have Bernie, who's the head biologist slash botanist slash really bad at his job. He endangers himself and the entire crew on multiple occasions. It just wasn't good. And then again, there's William, who's the ship's AI, who honestly is the most interesting character and the most consistent character, because his whole characterization is that, yes, he's an AI, but as he's spending so much time with the crew, specifically Nico, he starts developing more feelings and also developing feelings of attraction and love for Nico, which eventually turns into a whole thing, but that's different. But he's the most consistent character in that we see a very consistent arc for him. Episode one basically goes, Nico and William wake up the rest of the crew. We find out who they are as people, which can be summarized completely by the word annoying. And then we find out there's discussion on where they're gonna go, there's discussion on the trip, and then eventually Yerxa decides that Nico is unfit, and then he basically rallies everyone to agree with him, and they stage a mutiny, and they attack Nico, put her back into somatic sleep, which is where they were, which there's a whole other thing with their somatic sleep, but I'll get there. Basically, they start trying to slingshot around the sun. It damages their ship. They wake up Nico. Nico takes over. And though Yerxa did a mutiny and up and basically committed crimes, because their somatic sleep is damaged because of the damage to the ship, they can't put him back into Soma sleep. They just decide that, oh no, he's just still second in command. There's no other options. We can't just keep him in lockdown until we get it fixed. He's just second in command. There's nothing we can do. As Yerxa and Nico are repairing the ship in like a boiler room or something, there's a whole conversation about what Yerxa would do in Nico's spot, and Yerxa basically admits, it's as he had admitted prior, wouldn't have let him live, essentially, if there was a mutiny. He'd also admitted to her earlier that there's no just expectation of danger with the mission for Yerxa. He is fully on board with people dying for this mission, which isn't something you really want to admit. That's kind of like the sign of someone who's not all there mentally and maybe shouldn't be in charge of f***ing anything. Yerxa grabs a blade. He tries to sneak up on Nico. Nico turns around and sees him. She kicks him because it's self-defense, because he was going to kill her. Kicks him into an open electrical field. I feel like that's something that would have been priority one to fix, but that's just me. Yerxa gets electrocuted and dies. Surprise, he's dead. And that's the end of episode one. Now, I know what you're thinking. Nico probably did everything she could to convince the crew, who already don't trust her, that what she did was self-defense and Yerxa attacked her and she had to kill him because he was going to kill her. No, she straight up goes in and tells him very calmly, he was a danger to the ship. He needed to die, essentially. No, I wouldn't trust you after that. You sound like a psycho. So obviously some of them are like not cool with the fact that she killed someone, because I wouldn't be. You know, we're stuck on a ship with this person. I don't trust you now. Remember how I mentioned their Soma is stupid? It's broken, so they can't put anyone into Soma sleep, but they can wake people up. So they wake up her second in command, Cass, who also apparently was the love of Yerxa's life and they were together. So obviously that's awkward. Yerxa's death was so stupid. It was just handled really poorly, and it's brought up only once later, but everyone else just kind of forgets about it pretty quickly. Most of the deaths on this show were handled really poorly in that there was no buildup. Yerxa dying, I was just like, oh, he's dead. That's it. He was in one episode and now he's dead, and I'm thinking it's gonna set the tone for the rest of the season. Nope. It's like 2-3 episodes and then we forget about him. Let's talk about the Soma slash somatic tubes. A lot of sci-fi has things like this, so it's essentially a cryogenic sleep where when you're sleeping for light speed travel, or in this case faster than light, FTL, you basically go into a cryogenic type of sleep and you don't age in that time, and it helps basically preserve the mission and also keeps you from eating your supplies while traveling. Their Soma is stupid. The rules for their Soma are stupid. It's very inconsistent because based on the first episode, everyone's woken up from Soma and there's an interaction between Sasha and August where Sasha makes a comment about uniforms and August goes, missions haven't used uniforms in decades. How old are you anyway? And I'm gonna talk about that uniform comment later. With the comment about Sasha's age, I was like, oh my god, that could be interesting. Like, maybe he's been the diplomat or the senator on so many different missions. He's actually been in Soma for years at a time or months at a time, so maybe he looks like he's 25, 27, however the f- we're supposed to believe that Sasha is. And the reality is he's actually like 40 or 50. When Javier fixes Soma temporarily, Nico gets stuck on a dream bender as they're trying to save her. We find out that Soma is actually new tech. Like, less than 5 years new tech. Okay, so the age comment was pointless. The entire ship has different technical issues. Basically every single episode, there's a different we have to beat the clock to stop this technical issue problem. The only thing that's consistently broken is the Soma tubes, the only thing. But it's also not consistently broken because the way this show works is that they can wake people up no problem, but they can't put them back into Soma. It's frankly stupid. There's one point where the Soma tubes are first broken and Oliver and August go in to try and fix the Soma tubes and they comment on how hot it is in the room. And I'm like, oh my God, everyone's like being cooked alive. Everything malfunctioned, everyone overheated because the tech couldn't regulate their body temperatures in the Soma sleeve. The whole room being hot, just an excuse to get August in her sports bra so Oliver can ogle her awkwardly while talking about his girlfriend back on Earth, who I definitely thought was fake and made up, but no, she's real. And we later find out that they apparently did have sex, but in VR, which was actually hilarious. Like I said, Soma, stupid. Next, I want to talk about the uniforms. Now, I don't know why the showrunners made the choice to not put them in uniforms. We find out during Nico's dreambender because she ends up picturing herself back on the Pilgrim, and we also see August's brother and a dude she was f***ing, who we find out is the love of her life aside from her husband. But she wasn't cheating on him because they weren't together at the time, so I don't know what the point of that was. When they first showed her walk up and kiss him, I thought that she had cheated on Eric, but no, that was just her boyfriend at the time. And this was 9 years later, but also her daughter is 8 years, so she got with Eric and got pregnant within like a year of being back on Earth. What was the point of that? But anyway, on that mission, when she's flashback, and again, this is 9 years ago, everyone on the Pilgrim is in uniform. What was the point of that comment if you weren't going to keep it consistent? I think that franchises and shows and movies often completely underestimate the marketing power of people cosplaying as your characters. There has not been a convention that I've been to where someone was cosplaying where at least one person has asked, oh my God, who are you dressed as? What are they from? You potentially just got a new person liking your. Why not have them in uniforms? What was the point of this? Because again, I can go and buy a bunch of strappy tops. No one's gonna know that I'm cosplaying as August. I can wear a crop top and plaid pants. No one's gonna know I'm cosplaying as Michelle. I can go wear a leather tank top, but it's not going to change the fact that I don't have Katie Sackhoff's arms. Just put them in uniforms. Put them in some type of spacesuits. At the very least, have them available. Because at one point, they're losing oxygen. Like, their oxygen is low. And they just all don't react. Like, even when it gets a little hard to breathe. You would think the first thing and be like, everyone get your suits on, get your air masks on at the very least in case we can't fix the problem because we're losing oxygen. You're telling me that I wasn't allowed to wear a tank top in high school. My shoulders might distract. Mr. Shouldn't be allowed around children, but I can have my midriff and my tits out in space. These people are just so stupid. All of them are incapable of taking something seriously and shit hits the fan. And again, all of these people are, yeah, young, but they're all supposed to be experts in their field, I'm assuming. At the very least, they're all scientists and engineers and doctors. And also, aside from Sasha, they're all trained astronauts. There's one point where they need to go harvest crystals for oxygen on a moon. And August and Oliver are in a cave. And August realizes that the oxygen levels are at 19% in the cave. So rather than monitor it for more than 3 seconds to see if there's a sudden spike or if there's any other dangerous stuff in the atmosphere aside from oxygen, she just whips off her mask and keeps working because I can see again because her mask was fogging up. And then Oliver agrees with her, and then Cass comes in, tells them to put their masks down. They put their masks down and then she walks away. They laugh and lift it back up again and continue mining the crystals with their masks up. On that same planet, Bernie wanders off to go get soil samples because he didn't listen to Javier. He doesn't know how to read his own charts from his samples and ends up bringing a virus onto the ship that infects everyone and kills two people. Sort of. Kills one of them and then one of them decides to get yeeted out of the airlocks. We're talking about the virus next because it's stupid. Bernie just routinely makes dumb decisions that endanger himself and other people. He is immune to the virus. He's a carrier for it, but he infects everyone else. On a different moon, he was the only smart one at first because he was worried about infecting everyone else with something else. So he wears a full mask, full suit, and is the only smart one because no one else is, because this moon is basically Earth. I don't give a shit if it's almost Earth. I don't give if the moon is called Earth 2. Wear your protective helmets. Wear your gear. Be logical. Your team literally has been infected by a virus from another planet. It doesn't matter if the atmospheric levels are the same as on Earth, if not better than Earth. You all just survived a virus that infected your whole team and could have killed all of you. Why are you not covered head to toe? They mess with him a bit, get him to take off the gear. At one point, he gets scared by an alien scorpion spider thing, falls down, and cuts his leg on Fauna. He doesn't do anything about it. He doesn't say anything. It rips a hole in his pants and cuts him to the point that we can see blood. You were on a foreign moon. I don't care if something spits at you and you don't feel anything. You report that to the doctor that you're partnered up with. He is a botanist and a biologist. Like, what the f***? dude. That one small scrape nearly turns his leg into basically Groot. Luckily, he's with Zane. Zane fixes it. And then Bernie hobbles around for like 2 episodes, and then he's fine, and it's done. That's it. Also on this planet, Nico and Cass go on a drug binge because they're, again, not wearing protective headgear, and they wander into the pollen patch of this tree that just gets everyone super high. Bernie endangers everyone again later because he goes and takes one of the flowers that made Nico and Cass high and brings it onto the ship so that he can make e-juice from it. There's more dumb choices in Protocol, but we're gonna move on. The illness episode ends up with 2 different people dying. We have Petra, who was a character that was on the ship from the beginning. Didn't even have a job on the ship. She was literally there to die. They didn't try and build her character up. Her death was literally just to cause fear for the other characters. That's it. We're not supposed to feel sorry about Petra dying. No one even had like a friendship with her, it seemed. Everyone's just like, oh, Petra's dead. Basically, the way the virus works is that it affects different parts of your nervous system. So Petra, it made every part of her nervous system feel like it was on fire, and so she started convulsing. And then suddenly she got better. And so they're like, oh, okay, so it's just like once it goes through, it's like the flu. Like once it passes through, you'll be fine. But then suddenly, once Petra realizes she's okay, suddenly she has difficulty talking. Her nervous system breaks out of her neck aliens style and yeets itself out of her body, and she dies. Everyone's going to die, but they have to save the mission, so they're going to go through the sterilization protocol, which involves all of them being yeeted out of the airlock. They wake up Amos, who should have been on Team A. He can do everything Bernie can do, but better and more consistently and smarter, but he's also boring, so I kind of understand. Yeah, he dies because him and Bernie tried to develop a cure, and he injects himself with it, and it basically just speeds up the virus and makes him feel like he's on fire, and so Bernie has to send him out of the airlock. That sucks. They're all going to be yeeted out of the airlock, and then William is going to sterilize the ship and then wake up a whole new crew. Before they do that, though, William and Bernie realize that William helps kill off the bacteria for the virus because William emits a low levels of gamma radiation. No one turns into Hulk, but that would honestly be more realistic than some of the Basically, they decide that they're going to fly by a star and be in its orbit for a while to have them be near enough gamma radiation to kill the virus, and then they're fine. It'll kill the virus in them, and it'll disinfect the ship and save everyone. They do this, it's fine. They're all in excruciating pain when this is happening. Apparently, none of them knew that gamma radiation could have any negative side effects. We find out that they're all sterile now. I'm sorry, this is gonna sound really insensitive, but that's it. In the context of the show, sterilization seems like not enough for being around gamma radiation. I don't know. They should have made all their hair fall out. They should have given them like third degree burns or something. But again, we want to keep our crew looking hot and sexy so they can all fuck later. So we can't have that. So instead, they're just sterilized. They also don't stick with sterilization because later, August gets fucking pregnant from one of these two. Side note, good for her, but like, why? I was watching Netflix on my phone, and when I heard August say, "Do you smell that?" I straight up threw my phone. Bullshit. They're not doing this. Not only is she not sterile, but neither is Javier or Oliver or all of them. So what was the point of the gamma sterilized everyone if you weren't gonna make it consistent or stick with it? Because that kind of means that there was like no repercussions from the gamma radiation. There are a lot of things that are said by the characters on the show that are just never touched on again or they're gone back on later. For example, early on in one of the episodes, Michelle is talking with Sasha and Sasha's feeling kind of hopeless. You know, he's shouldn't be on the ship. He's just in the way of everyone. He can't do anything. He's just the politician on board. There's nothing he can really do. He's not a scientist or anything. And Michelle kind of encourages him, like, aren't you like the youngest governor ever? And we find that he's like the youngest senator ever. And I was like, okay, cool. I don't like this character, but that's an accomplishment. I can acknowledge that. Later on in a whole different episode, we find out that he's not just a senator, that he's the Secretary of Defense's son. Like, thank you for making me like this character even less. After the illness episode where they're sterilized, Javier is upset because he wanted to have a family. And August lets him know that her parents, before the mission, took her to Canada to have some of her eggs frozen. And at the time, she was kind of like, oh, okay, like overkill. Like, why didn't you do that? Kind of tries to make her feel bad about the fact that like her parents have money and that she got to do that. It's not her fault, but he's upset. It makes sense. And she just gets kind of serious and she's like, I had my eggs frozen so that if I died on this mission, my parents would still have grandchildren. And then it's never spoken about again. Can we go back and unpack that? Because that's kind of like really upsetting. Because keep in mind, her brother died on the Pilgrim. So that kind of sets up the expectation that maybe she doesn't matter to her parents and that all they care about is her ability to give them a grandchild. That's really depressing and really sad, and like we should unpack that because maybe there's something going on. But it's never brought up again, and we don't have to worry about that because she's pregnant. On the episode where Nico and Cass are high, they're like admitting all this to each other. Cass basically tells Nico that she believes Nico is psychotic, and Nico admits to Cass that if Cass was in charge, everyone would die on the mission. Wow. One of the things that also was said is that Cass asks Nico if she would ever abandon her, and when Nico says no, she says, oh, you abandoned Jana, which is Nico's daughter. That's never brought up again. Both of them said things they regret while high. Nothing new. Everyone's done it. They chose to focus on the psychotic comment in another episode. Personally, I would give way more of a about someone saying that I abandoned my child when I'm literally on a mission to, like, protect her and the planet that she lives on. I'd give more of a shit about the comments about my kid. I really wouldn't give a shit about someone calling me psychotic, but maybe that's just a Nico thing. Michelle's death was a whole other point on my original list because it was something that showed us what we could have had for the entirety of the show. It was something that was really well done, but also done very poorly. Something that they kept doing with a lot of these characters is they would build up relationships within the same episode that something important happened. For example, in the episode where Michelle dies, find out that Michelle and Cass have been close for years and trained alongside each other. Basically, they have another technical malfunction because it's the Salvare, nothing works. Michelle's complaining again, and Cass snaps at her and says, you need to actually care about other people for once. What's happening is that their exotic matter chamber, which deals with their artificial gravity and all that, is overheating or something, and so they have to basically manually shut it off, and the way to do that is for someone, in this case Michelle, to go in and unplug all of the tubes so it automatically shuts off and then restarts itself. So basically we're unplugging it and plugging it back in because that's how we do it on the Salvare. So Michelle goes in and she's warned going in, exotic matter, Rick's apart organic matter at the atomic level. Obviously she's human, she's organic matter. So after she rips off the first tube, the alarms are still going off, it hasn't stopped, so she knows she has to keep ripping out more tubes. As she's doing it, lesions are forming on her arms, tears are forming in her skin, she's coughing up blood, her eyes are bleeding, her eyes are swelling up, she's dying in front of us as she's doing this, and she keeps going, she does it, she succeeds. And then Cass runs in finally, and we think that Michelle is dead, but no, we realize Michelle's not dead. Cass just has to watch her die and try and keep her comfortable. The damage is already done. There's nothing they can do. The exotic matter has already done its damage. She is basically disintegrating from the inside out, and so Cass just has to sit there and watch Michelle die. And the entire time they're talking, it's the one death that happened that actually got me to tear up a little bit, because Michelle is a character that they had built up, and yeah, this dynamic between her and Cass wasn't built up, but there's one moment where Michelle says, it would have been pretty great if you could have saved me, and Cass is just broken as she's holding her hand, and it's like, oh my god, this sucks. This is, like, really hard to watch. And it was also just the most grotesque death, because yeah, having your nervous system yeeted out, that's something I've seen before, but Michelle was literally disintegrating to the point that her bones are coming through in her face, and then we see in another shot that she's just a bloody pile of organs now. We see Cass's reaction and Nico's reaction. Nico's pretty reserved about it, but she's trying to be strong for Cass, so that kind of makes sense. The rest of the crew really doesn't talk about it, and we don't even get to see Sasha's reaction, even though it's her boyfriend. At different points in the show, everyone starts. Episode 8 is the episode with the most sex, if that's what you're after. We don't even get to see Sasha's reaction to Michelle's death because his brain's been taken over by an alien because he's a fucking idiot. On the moon they went to where a lot of the stupidity happened, that's where Sasha got taken over by the alien, and now he is the alien in his brain. Moving on. The Akaya are the aliens that sent the artifact to Earth and sent the artifact to the moon, etc., and they're now the alien that has taken over Sasha's brain. Now they find out through Sasha from Javier that the way that they're going to handle the Akaya or the aliens, because they don't know who they are yet, things go south, is that they're going to focus their force field into a beam and basically blow up the planet. That's one of the options if things go south. When they learn this, they go, genocide. That's the plan. And it's like this whole big thing, and he basically, because this alien, and supposedly Sasha, don't want to kill the Akaya, they basically try to get rid of the Salvare by attacking William, and by doing that, they basically encourage William to show his feelings to Nico. And obviously, Nico's human, he's an AI, they can't really be in love. There's no real love there, even though they kind of did the do. What the fuck is this show? Anyway, they all try to kill each other. Javier ends up brain dead because they use probes from his eyes to get memories out of his head and basically leave him brain dead because they took everything out of his head. Nico is trying to wake up manually because, again, Javier is incapacitated, but they need someone who's a technical engineer to try and get William back online. So she tries to wake her up from Soma manually because they don't have control of the ship at the time. Because everything that happened with Nico rejecting him, William couldn't handle it, and he basically tried to reboot himself. And so while he was being rebooted, Sasha slash the Akaya took control of everything, and so Nico tried to manually wake up Asami, who was another person who could do Javier's job, but not to the same degree, and so Sasha kills her by suffocating her inside the Soma tube, which sounds horrible. Anyway, they end up getting Sasha locked away. Sasha starts faking a seizure because he's trying to get them to kill him. Because Sasha knows that the Akai can take control of him at any point. He's already killed someone. He's already hurt Javier. He's basically begging them to kill him. And at one point, he starts faking a seizure, grabs Zane, and is about to kill them, strangle them, and makes Bernie shoot him. So surprise, Sasha's dead. They take the alien Akaya thing, which is basically like a centipede that attaches to his brainstem. They take it out of his brain by cutting open his head. It's all electrical impulses, so they use William to take out all of the bad stuff from the electrical impulses from the thing, and then they just let it attach itself to Javier so that Javier is now no longer brain dead. What? Moving on. Season one ends with them going to the planet they were always planning on going to. It's not the Akaya's planet. It's a planet that had been taken over by the Akaya, where there's another artifact, and they find one of the aliens there who has not been taken over by the Akaya, and then they have also basically an AI all-purpose translator person that explains to Cass and Nico who they are, where they are, that type of thing, and says, yeah, if the artifact's on your planet, it's too late. They're there. It's happening. They use the Savari's laser beam to blow up the artifact on that planet, but they find out from that voice thing that there are 300 other probes on 300 other planets, including Earth, out in the galaxy. So they leave the planet, and as they're leaving, they see three more of the same spaceships from the first episode coming towards them. The spaceships pass them. They turn around to look at the planet. They're not fast enough to beat them back to the planet, but the Akaya use the ships to blow up the planet where they just destroyed the artifact. Everything's hopeless. There's nothing they can do. They can't go back to Earth and blow up the artifact because the Akaya are just gonna be like, okay, this planet's no longer a waste of our time. Let's get it out of this galaxy and blow up the planet. They need to find another option. My problem with that is that while they're on the planet, they find skeletons of these aliens from that planet around the artifact, near the artifact, and inside the skulls, you can see the alien probe thing inside their skulls, which shows that the Akaya basically infected this planet and the species just to kill them off. Like, there was no point in them being alive. And then obviously, the moment they saw that the planet couldn't be used for them anymore, they just nuked the planet. Isn't that genocide? Which is exactly what the Akaya that took over Sasha's brain was like angry about and tried to kill everyone over. I'm inclined to believe that this is a metaphor for some things, but I don't think the showrunners are smart enough to do that. I don't think they thought this through enough. They don't get back to Earth at the end of the first season. Earth is having its own Harper, who, again, Selma Blair's character, the only one I care about, also has been taken over by the Akaya, and we find out she claims, even though it's her Akaya brain, that she accepted it into her life, which is kind of what Sasha had to do, but before he had accepted it, he saw himself split, so he saw his Akaya self and then himself, and then they just kind of merged together, but then he was still two separate people, so it didn't really make a lot of sense. But basically, Harper is now an Akaya, and she goes back on the news because she's like a social media news person, starts talking about the Akaya and how they're here to help and they're here to be good. And so it's like, okay, so Earth's and the Silvari's because we already know they're low on food. The season ends with me wondering, what was the point of any of this? Because so many of the other little issues that they had leading up to this moment had nothing to do with the final elements of anything. Much like this video, there was so much that didn't flow and that didn't make sense together, and it was just so unnecessary. As I'm filming this, Another Life has not been renewed by Netflix for season two, and I don't think it will be. A lot of the special effects for the show were pretty good, and I know those weren't cheap. And based on the reception for the show, there's no way they're going to be able to justify the cost for another season. Please don't give it another season. I understand this review was all over the place, but so was the show. Thank you for watching. Shout out to Catherine, Sarah, and Aaron for supporting me on my Patreon. If you would also like to support me on my Patreon, the link will be listed down below. If you'd like to follow me on all my social media, that'll be all up here. Let me know what you thought of this video, or what you thought of my other reviews, or if you saw Another Life, what did you think of it? Let me know. Are there any other bad Netflix shows or movie you want me to review? Let me know. Comment down below. That's it. Like, comment, subscribe, and all that good stuff. Thank you for watching. Like I said, everyone just kind of f***ed at a certain point. The only relationship that I was like, oh, holy shit, they're doing this, good for them, was August with Oliver and Javier. I don't know about you guys. I'm so f***ing tired of love triangles in media. More polyamorous relationships. Let's mix it up a little bit.